Good morning, everyone. Would you stand to your feet? Come on, put your hands together. We're gonna sing.
Everybody, put your hands together. Sing with me.
Your
sing it out.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
There you go.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
Yeah.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
Like Jesus.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
Like Jesus.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
Like Jesus.
There's no other name, no other name like Jesus.
Like Jesus.
You are good all the time, and your love endures forever. You are good all the time, you are good.
Good God, a good, good Father. We sing to you and we celebrate who you are. Let's just sing this out.
I heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I heard.
Yeah, you sing.
Do you-
Against us on all sides, we will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. For in the hour of our darkest day, we will not tremble. We won't be afraid. Hope is rising like the light of dawn. Our God is for us, He has overcome. For we trust in our God, and through His unfailing love, we will not be shaken.
All those put our hands together for one. God, we thank you that we can trust in you. We thank you that you are a good, good Father. And Lord, that in those times when storms and trials come with us, that we can stand firm on you, knowing that we will never have to be shaken or in despair. Think of that old hymn that says, "On Christ the solid rock I stand, and all of the ground is sinking sand." We love you, God. Thank you for the hope that we have in you. Amen. Amen. Let's praise it one more time, church. Amen. Amen. You guys sound awesome this morning. Welcome to A2 Church. We are so thrilled you're here, especially if it's your first time with us. We are just so excited that you're in the house with us this morning. This is a time we call our Connect time, where we get to meet one another, greet another, move from one side of the building, front to the back, let's shake some hands and hug some necks this morning.
We got two good mornings. I think we got a couple more good mornings in the morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to A2 Church. My name is Josh Power. I'm the student pastor here. If you're a first, second, or third time guest, welcome or welcome back. We're so glad that you joined us. The only thing we ask our guests to do is to fill out one of these connection cards. It's located in the seat back in front of you. So go ahead and pull one of those out, fill it out. For that matter, guests and regulars, you guys know the routine. I'd like to invite everybody, pull it out, fill it out, let us know that you're here. There's a section on the bottom that you can indicate if you'd like to sign up for an event, or that section can also be used for a prayer request. We have an awesome prayer team that would love to partner with you in prayer. If you're new, over the next 75 minutes, what you're going to experience is some worship. We'll open up the Bible and see what the Word has to say to us today, and there'll be some prayer time at the end. If you call A2 Church home, now's also a great time to prepare to honor God with His tithe and our offering. We never ask our guests to give. We hope that this worship experience is our gift to you. Another thing that we need to highlight today is social media. We'd like to go ahead and invite all of you guys to take out your phones, pull them out, sign on to Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, and follow us. We'd love to stay connected with you through these social media sites, and we love the fact that we can continue the conversation from here into social media and throughout the week. So check that stuff out. While you're filling all that stuff out, I'm going to highlight a couple things. When you walked in, you should receive one of these. It's jam-packed with information. We're going to highlight a couple of those. First off, water baptism. If you've made a decision over the past couple months and you say, okay, what's the next step? If you made that decision to follow God for the first time, or maybe you've recommitted to Him after being away from Him for a while, this is the next step. It's water baptism, and we'd love to celebrate with you. It's on January 24th. It'll be offered in both worship experiences. So if that's you, go ahead and indicate that on the connection card, and we'll reach out to you this week. The other thing is Discover A2 Church is on January 31st. If you're new to A2 Church and you're trying to figure out what we're all about, what we're doing, and what's happening here, come and check us out on January 31st at 4:30 in the A2 student room, and you'll be able to meet some cool people, hear about the mission, the vision, the values of A2, and just get to have a good experience with fellowship and hang out with the team. So plan on being there for that. You can indicate that you're coming to that on the connection card as well. And that same day, January 31st, it's a big day, we're going to have our night of worship and healing. Plan on being here for that. It's at 6 o'clock in this room. We'd love to pack this room out. God's always done amazing things through that. We'll have some worship, a message, and some prayer time at the end. Chris is going to come up in a moment to continue Best Year Ever. That's a series that we're in. But before we do that, we're going to hand it back to the worship team. Thank you. Thank you.
things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that we thought were dead are breathing in life again. You cause your sun to shine on darkest nights. For all that you've done, we will pour out our love. This will be Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Sing, the hopeless have found their hope. Orphans now have a home. All that was lost has found its place in you. You lift our weary head. You make us strong instead. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Jesus, we love you.
Poured out on the feet of Jesus. Jesus, I pray that our love, our devotion to you would be expressed not only in this room, but through the everyday, ordinary actions of our life. May we pour out all of our affection, all of our devotion on your feet, for you and you alone are worthy. And if you agree with that and comfortable in saying it, you can say aloud, amen. Are we just saying about pouring out our devotion and affection on the feet of Jesus? So one more time, would you give him an ovation of your praise and worship? Let's let it ring in this place today. Let it ring. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for who you are and all that you have done. You may be seated. Let me try this as you're being seated. Good morning, A2 Church.
Morning.
Hey, when you entered, you should have received one of these, a self-contained package of Holy Communion. If you did not receive one of these, if you'll just hold up your hand, I'm going to ask Justin and members of our guest services team to walk these center aisles, and they'll bring one your way, and you'll want to hold on to this till the end of our worship experience, and we will experience Holy Communion together. They're coming down the aisles right now, so keep your heads lifted, looking around. We are in a series. As Josh has already mentioned, that series is called Best Year Ever, and this morning is part two of a message we began last week called A New Season. For the last few weeks, we've been talking about getting a grasp on God's dream, God's vision for your life. We've been looking at a group of people who seized a dream that was centuries in the making. A dream that began with a guy named Abraham. A dream that outlasted, endured 400 years of slavery. A dream that survived 40 years of walking in circles in the wilderness. According to several scholars, think of this. According to several scholars, the promised land was an 11 to 13 day walk from Egypt. An 11 to 13 day walk from Egypt, less than 2 weeks. But because of their disobedience, doubt, discouragement, grumbling, griping, complaining, the people of God turned a 2 week walk into a 40 year treadmill run. Can you imagine this, being stuck on a treadmill for 40 years? It's what happened to this group of people. For 40 years, they walked in circles, logged lots of miles, but ended up going absolutely nowhere. It took 40 years for them to get unstuck. I just want to ask this morning, anybody here ever felt stuck? Same old, same old. I mean, day after day after day after day, you wake up at the same old time, get up out of the same old bed, go to the same old bathroom, look in the same old mirror, take the same old shower, dry off with the same old towel, shave the same old face or legs or whatever it might be, walk into the same old kitchen, pour the same old cereal into the same old bowl, kiss the same old wife or husband on the same old cheek, get the same old car, drive off to the same old job, sit in the same old chair, at the same old cubicle, listen to the same old boss, tell the same old jokes, laugh in the same old way, clock out the same old time, get back in the same old car, drive to the same old house, through the same old door, eat the same old dinner, fall asleep in the same old chair, watching the same old news, get up, get in the same old bed, ask your wife the same old question, get the same old answer, roll out, go back to sleep the same old way, and that's it. Anybody here? From day to day, it's just the same old, same old. Same old routine, same old habits, same old sins, same old failures, same old mistakes, same old disappointments, same old discouragement, same old depression, same old rut, same old letdowns. Anybody here tired of the same old, same old? Anybody ready to get unstuck? Ready to move out of the wilderness into your promised land? I came with good news. It's the point of this series. Our Joshua, our Yeshua, his name is Jesus, came to lead us out of Egypt. He destroyed the Pharaoh of this world. He destroyed the evil one, his works and their effects, rendering him completely, not partially, completely defeated. But not only did he take us out of Egypt, he came to get Egypt out of us. He came to lead us out of the wilderness and into our promised land. And get this, our promised land isn't a piece of real estate. It's a state of a heart, soul, and mind that has been set free by the power of the gospel. It is a state of being saturated by God's grace. It's a life lived in grace. And grace is a lot more than God's unmerited, unconditional favor. Here's what grace is. Somebody summed it up like this. Grace is God's power motivated by his mercy, working to fulfill his compassion. See, we're not only saved by grace, but we're sustained by grace. And God's grace, you need to know this, is not only reckless, it is relentless. In other words, in life, you may get knocked down, but God's grace will refuse to allow you to be knocked out. Grace pulls you back up, looks you in the face. Grace becomes your Mickey in Rocky V. Anybody remember that? Mickey is dead in Rocky V, but Rocky gets knocked out. He's on the street. He's laying there in the street, but he has a vision of Mickey, and Mickey is yelling at him. Mickey, that little scrawny man, is yelling at him, and Mickey is saying what Jesus is saying to you. Get up! Get up! Get up, you son of a Baptist. Mickey says another word. Get up, you son of a Baptist, because Jesus loves you. That's what God is saying to some of you today. Get up! Get up! I love you, and I refuse to leave you here. Now, here's the promised land then and there. Then and now, excuse me. Then and now. Here's the promised land. Three things. It meant for them, and it means for us. Number one, rest and peace, even in the face of challenges. The promised land is about rest and peace, even in the face of challenges. The Bible describes the promised land as a place of rest. In fact, the text we read last week, it says in Joshua 21, verse 44, God gave Israel rest on every side. Hebrews 3, 4, we're not going to look there in depth, though you could take a number of weeks, just in chapters 3 and 4 of Hebrews. It uses the same language to describe our promised land. It calls it a place of rest. Let's look at just one verse, Hebrews 4, 1. God's promise of entering into his rest still stands, so we ought to tremble with fear that some of you might fail to experience it. In other words, it's entirely possible to be born again but live your life in the wilderness. And we ought to tremble in fear that we live all of our Christian life in the wilderness and not enter into his rest. Now, rest is a life saturated by grace. It's a life filled with a deep sense of the peace of God. Rest doesn't refer to the absence of activity, action, work, or vocation. See, the promised land wasn't a quaint, cute little retirement community where all the people of God would have to do for the rest of their lives was sit around, play golf, eat grapes, clip coupons. When the Bible refers to rest in Hebrews 3, 4, it doesn't mean that you won't still face giants, because the people of God faced giants in Canaan. But they were filled with such faith that they actually looked at Joshua in the face of giants. This comes up in Joshua 14, verse number 12. One man by the name of Caleb looked at Joshua and said, hey, I want a particular piece of real estate in the promised land. I want this mountain because I heard giants live there. But if the Lord is with me, he will enable me to drive them out just as he has said. See, rest doesn't mean that you still won't have challenges, because you will. It doesn't mean that sometimes your heart won't be beating out of your chest. Sometimes there'll be a big lump in your throat. But in the Bible, rest, peace, security, it doesn't refer to the absence of problems, challenges, setbacks, or pains. It refers to God's power coming to you to meet you in the middle of those problems, challenges, setback, and pain. It refers to God's grace coming alongside of you and giving you the ability to get through those difficulties, knowing that God is with you, God is for you, and God refuses to give up on you. That's what rest looks like. Let me give you one passage in the New Testament that defines rest for the people of God. It doesn't refer to the absence of challenges. Some of you are so undone with one jab from the evil one, one right hook, one left uppercut. It just puts you down on the mat and you stay there. But you need to know, even in those moments of weakness, you can experience grace. Here's what Paul said about it. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. Let's just say it out loud. But he, that's God, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ can work through me. You see, that's what rest is. It's when your life becomes so saturated by grace that even in moments of weakness, you look up and you say, this is going to be an opportunity for God's grace to work through me, in me, and for me. I am depending on him, not in or on my own self-effort. That's good news. Now, that's what the promised land is. It's a place of rest and peace, even in the middle of challenges. Second thing the promised land is, it's a place of God's abundant provision and supply. Abundant provision and supply. There's an expression that gets used over and over and over again. And if you're interested in this sort of thing, if you'll check out the extended notes that we'll post on the blog later tonight in the podcast, later tonight or sometime tomorrow, you can check out a lot of the references. I didn't even list all of the references in the extended notes. Over and over again, there's an expression that gets applied to the promised land, an expression that describes what it's going to be like, what it is like. It's called, over and over, a land flowing with milk and honey. That sounds a lot like my kind of place. Because I want to tell you, there are two things this southern guy likes. I love milk. I love honey. I love milk and I love honey. Let me read you one description of the promised land in the book of Exodus. It is one of my favorite descriptions of the promised land. Here's how it reads. God said, I've taken a good long look at the affliction of my people in Egypt. This is while they were still in Egypt. I've heard their cries for deliverance from their slave masters. I know all about their pain. Oh, some of you just need that part of it. Some of you need to know this morning that God has heard your cries for help, that God has heard your cries for deliverance, that when you've lain in bed at night praying that God would get you out of this mess, God has heard your cries, and God knows all about your pain. And look at the next phrase. And now I've come down to help them. That is such great news. Our God is the God who comes down to help them. And I love this next expression, to pry them loose from the grip of Egypt, to get them out of that country and bring them to a good land. And I love this. Sort of reminds me of Dixie Chicks. That goes far too back for many of you. To a land of wide open spaces. Yeah, you can sing that later on. A land flowing with milk and honey. That's the description of the promised land. It was a land of abundant provision and supplies. Let me just give you a picture. In Numbers chapter 13, 14, when 12 spies were sent to do a recon report on the land, they come back carrying a single cluster of grapes so large that it took two of them to carry it on one pole. They also brought back fruit from the land. And when they gave their report to Moses, they said, we entered the land, and this is what they said, it is a land flowing with milk and honey, and this is some of the fruit. Now that expression, flowing with milk and honey, it is jammed with meaning. Let me tell you three things about it. First of all, it means that the land was fertile. In other words, when you planted stuff there, it would actually grow. It meant that the land, secondly, was fruitful. Not only did stuff grow in the land, it multiplied, it increased. The crops were bumper crops. And the third thing it refers to is quality. The quality of the fruit was exceptional. See, when it came to fruit, agriculture, crops in the land, everything worked with you, not against you. I just want to ask you, can you imagine what life lived like that would be like? Can anybody here imagine entering into a period of exponential breakthrough growth? Can anybody here imagine entering into a season of fruitfulness in your life like you've never experienced? Can you imagine entering into a season of transformational change that was so qualitative that people around you looked at you and said, oh my goodness, what is happening in them? Because the fruit of the Spirit was so exponentially increasing in your life. It was so dramatic that it could only be chalked up to the grace of God. That's what the promised land is. God said, I'm going to get them out of Egypt, bring them into a good land, a land of wide open spaces, a land flowing with milk and honey. Now this meant a lot to those people. It meant a whole lot to them, because you need to remember their diet for the last 40 years. Their diet, day in and day out, it was God's provision. But I want to tell you guys, so much of even a good thing can become incredibly redundant. I mean, for 40 years, a husband never had to look at his wife and say, hey, babe, what are we having for breakfast? Oh, that's right, manna. What'd you pack for my lunch? Oh, that's right, manna. What are we eating for dinner? Oh, that's right again, manna. All of a sudden, they went from manna every meal, every day, to a buffet. And we're not talking Chowtown quality buffet, guys. I mean, we're talking Ross Bridge breakfast buffet in the morning. Ask Shannon Johnson to hook you up. Stay for the second service. We're talking that kind of quality buffet. Hey. One more thing, really interesting. How does this apply to me? It's really interesting that there is one thing in the Bible that gets compared to milk and honey repeatedly. Repeatedly. Anybody know what that is in the Bible that gets compared to milk and honey all throughout Old Testament and New? Anybody know? The Word of God. The Word of God gets compared to milk and honey. Why? Because when we eat on and when we feed on the Word of God, here's what it always does. It always produces growth. It is always fruitful, and it always brings about a qualitative change in our life. In fact, let me give you this passage from Isaiah 55. It describes the Word of God like this. It is the same with my Word. I send it out, and everybody say this out loud, it always produces fruit. Say it again. It always produces, you need that one more time. It always produces fruit. It will accomplish what I want it to. It will prosper everywhere I send it. That's the power of the Word of God. One more thing about abundant provision and supply. I know I already said one more thing, but I've got one more thing. And I may have one more thing after this thing. Hey, bring up Ephesians 1:3. This is God's promise for you. All praise to God. This is our promise, Lynn. The Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with, anybody see it? Every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. Did you notice it says he has blessed us? Not he will bless us, or he might bless us, or someday if we earn it, he could possibly bless us. It says he has already blessed us. That's why this year can become your best year ever. It's not because you're so smart, capable, savvy, or intelligent. It is because you, if you know Christ, are already potentially living in your promised land. He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. Or how about this one? Bring up Romans chapter 8, verse 32. This is an incredible promise. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us what? Anybody see it? All things. In other words, if God paid the ultimate price for our redemption, we can trust him with everything else in our life. I mean, compared to the price he paid for redemption, everything and anything else we could ask is a piece of cake. Our God wants to bring us into a land of abundant provision and supply. And I do have one more thing in addition to that thing. Anybody ever realize that one of the names that gets used for God all throughout the Old Testament is the name El Shaddai. El Shaddai. El Shaddai. Here's what it means. It means all-sufficient God. All-sufficient God. Anybody here ever have a check returned to you marked insufficient funds? Don't look so pious right now. You can go ahead. You can go ahead and raise your hand. Listen, that never happens with God. You won't ever write a check that he can't cash. He is all sufficient. God has never put heaven, he has never put grace, he has never put prayer on a rationing system or a budget. Our God is more than enough, and he wants to bring you into a land, a place of abundant provision and supply. Here's the third thing it means, okay? It means rest and peace, even in the midst of challenges. It means a place, the promised land means a place of abundant provision and supply. Here's the third thing. It's the realization of your destiny and purpose. All their lives, for 40 years, I mean, these guys were kids 40 years ago because the previous generation, God allowed all of them to die out who disbelieved his promise. So for 40 years, all these people had heard were stories about the promised land. All of their lives, they had heard stories about God's dream, about their destiny. But now, they live it. They actually experience it. I just want to ask you, anybody here tired of just reading the stories about what it could be like to be free? Anybody here tired of just reading, hearing stories, reading books, watching movies about what it could be like to live God's dream? Aren't you tired of always thinking about what could be, what should be, what might be? Anybody here ready to live the reality of the dream God called you to live in the here and now? That's what the promised land is all about. See, I don't know about you, but this has gripped me. For some of us, a new year. If we do not take steps this year, 18 days in, this new year will be what the past, whatever years have been. We'll just keep walking in the same old circles, doing the same old thing, repeating the same old year over and over and over again. And I came to tell you, it doesn't have to be like that. Now, I've given you a glimpse of what the dream is. Here's what I'm going to do next few minutes, and really it is a few minutes. I'm going to give you five principles for starting your new season, and I'm going to move fast, and I'm not going to have time to put a lot of meat on these bones, but at least you'll have the principles. I want to read the first 9 verses of Joshua 1. I'm going to give you 5 principles that are going to enable these people to possess their promised land. 5 principles that will give you the power to possess your promised land. And I may walk this stuff out on the blog. So let's read Joshua 1:1-9. It'll come up on the screen. I'm going to skip just a little bit of it that refers to the geography of the land, not because it is unimportant, but because I need to move with haste. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land that I am giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set foot, you will be on land I have given you." There it is again. "No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you. I will not abandon you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land that I swore to their ancestors that I would give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instruction Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all that you do. This is my command." 4th time he says it. "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." 5 principles. You ready? Here's the first principle. Your first new season principle. Learn from the past but refuse to live in it. Learn from the past but refuse to live in it. The book of Joshua, did you notice it begins with reality? After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, God said, "Moses, my servant, is dead." Well, thank you, God, for that awesome news. See, this was really stark. There was nobody like Moses, nobody. Moses was the man. He was the guy God had miraculously used to bring Israel out of Egypt through the wilderness. Moses was the guy who brought them to the edge of the promised land, to the edge of their dream, to the edge of their destiny. But the Bible opens up and says, Moses was dead. And the implication for many could have been, because Moses is dead, the dream is dead. But when it opens up this way, after the death of Moses, God said, "Moses is dead. The time has come for you to lead these people into the land I have given them." God is saying, "Hey, Josh, I want to tell you something. Moses was awesome. Moses was great. Moses did a lot of incredible stuff. I used him in some incredible ways, but Moses is dead. I'm still alive." Your leader has passed, but the leader lives on. Joshua, Moses is your past, but I'm still sovereign. I'm still active. I'm going to do something in you, through you, for you. My dream didn't die with Moses. I didn't sustain my dream through 400 years of slavery, 40 years in the wilderness, to let it die now. The dream lives on. So Joshua, you're doing right. Honor the past. Appreciate the past. Learn from the past. What I did with Moses was really, really cool. The people of God are going to be singing about it and talking about it for centuries and centuries. But I want you to know something. I'm going to do something new through you. You need to know the wilderness that some of you have been stuck in for however long is your past. And the principle that may be a game changer is this principle. It's good to honor the past, learn from the past, appreciate the past, but you need to determine today to never live in the past. Here's God's word for you, Isaiah 43, verse number 18 and 19. One of my favorite passages, I quote it regularly. Forget the former things. Everybody say the next phrase out loud and together. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? Guys, I want you to know something. Some of you need to hear this. God is a whole lot more interested in your future than he is your past. He's not fixated on your past, either the failures or the successes. He doesn't want to remind you of your mistakes. He doesn't want to live in your former glory days. God is interested in your present, and he wants to do something for you here and now. Now, let me give you the next four quick while Jordan or whomever comes to the keyboard. First, learn from the past, refuse to live in it. Here's the next four, very, very quickly. Let God and God alone define who you are and what you are about. It's really interesting. The book of Joshua begins by introducing us to Joshua like this. After the death of Moses, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. Moses is dead. The time has come for you to lead. For 40 years, Moses had been the mentor of Joshua. Joshua had been Moses' assistant, his protege, his right-hand guy. Moses had been the leader. Joshua had been number two, or probably number three or four in reality, because Aaron was likely Moses' number two. Now God says, you're the man. Stop being defined by who you were. Let me define you. You're the guy. Some of you need to close the books on the lesser version of you that has dominated you for decades. And you need to say, God, who do you say I am? I want to step into that reality. Three, God's promises, his power and presence are the ultimate game changers. Do you notice God says again and again, I have given them the land? He didn't say I might give it to them. He didn't say you must conquer it. He didn't say you must prove yourself worthy. He didn't say you have to earn your way. He said, this is my promise. I've given you the land. And furthermore, I will go with you into the land. And my promise, my power, my presence, they are enough. And let me just say they're enough for you. Four. God's word is the only game plan that will bring you into your promised land and keep you there. God's word. Imagine this. Suddenly you become responsible for 2 to 3 million people. They're your responsibility. That's twice the size of the greater Birmingham metropolitan area. And they're your responsibility. Imagine God speaking to you. What do you think God is going to suggest? Hey, I want you to finish your MBA. You really need that. Hey, I want you to get that MDiv. You really need that. Is that what God says? God says to this man, here's what I want you to do. Read my book. read my book. The best thing some of you can do 18 days into this new year is to make a determination that you are going to read the book. You're going to get into the book. I've got to give you this quote. In fact, there are two people, Greg Hawkins, Callie Parkinson. They did an extensive study with an independent market research group to determine the most important factors for spiritual growth. In other words, in our language, the most important factor for bringing people out of the wilderness into the promised land. Do you know what they said? Here's what they said. It boils down to this sentence or statement. Nothing has a greater impact on spiritual growth than reflection on Scripture. If churches could do only one thing to help people at all levels of spiritual maturity grow in their relationship with Christ, their choice is clear. They would inspire, encourage, and equip people to read the Bible. You want a new season? Make this book a priority. If you'll check out the blog, I'm going to give you a suggestion of three reading plans later today. And here's the fifth. Move. Move in the direction of your dream with strength. In other words, take action. Move with strength and courage. Anybody here tired of being stuck? Anybody here? It's time to move. I'm going to lead you in prayer. The journey out of Egypt through the wilderness to the promised land begins with surrendering your life to Jesus. So if you want to do that today, I want to lead you in prayer and just pray this prayer out loud and together with me. Say out loud, Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus, our Joshua, who came. He lived the life I could never live. He died for my sin in my place. He rose again to lead me out of my Egypt into my promised land. I trust him today. I surrender my all and declare that he is Lord, leader, Savior, the forgiver of my sin. I trust him completely. Way. Take out your communion if you would. Listen for just a moment. God's people left Egypt on the heels of what's called the first Passover, where the blood of a lamb was applied to the doorpost, sidepost of their home. And that night, when judgment passed over, the blood of the lamb protected them from judgment. They walked out with the blood of the lamb over the door, and that night they actually ate the lamb. They fed on the lamb that had been sacrificed to cover them. Can I tell you, they had all they needed to get out of Egypt and take an 11 to 13 day walk to the promised land. But they didn't trust the promise. They didn't trust the provision. We come to the conclusion of 14 days of prayer and fasting. And this is the real potential. That some of us could go back to the same old, same old. We could have the same old life, the same old way. And I will tell you, if you do, it will not be because of a lack of God's provision. He has already done everything that could be done to bring you out of Egypt, through the wilderness, into the promised land. And it's up to you to trust the provision. So we conclude 14 days of prayer and fasting by going back to the provision and remembering his body and blood given for us. So pull back the cellophane, revealing the bread. Take the bread in your hand. Pull back the foil revealing the juice, holding the cup in your hand. Take the bread in your hand. The night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's eat the bread." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you. Whenever you drink this, remember me." Let's drink the cup. Set aside the empty cup, if you would. Look this way for just a moment. Here's what we're going to do for the next 5-6 minutes. We're going to enter into worship. We're going to worship God by returning those connection cards. If you surrendered your life to Jesus, there's a place on that card. If everybody will take those out to mark, "I committed, recommitted my life to Christ," mark that. If you call this place home, we're going to worship by honoring God with his tithe and our offering. Go ahead and prepare that. And we're going to worship God by thanking him for what he's already provided that allows us to move out of Egypt through the wilderness that gets us into the promised land. It's enough. Did you hear me? It is enough. I'm going to say it again. It's enough. He that spared, Romans 8:32, his own son, spared not his own son, but freely gave him up for us all. Will he not also, along with him, freely give us all things? So we're just going to pour out our affection and devotion on Jesus. We're going back to what we sang just before I stepped up to speak. We're going to pour out all of our affection, all of our devotion. And if you're tired of the same old, just determine that from this day forward, you're going to trust the grace that has already been poured out upon you. Grace that is more than sufficient, more than enough. Are you ready to do that? After the container passes you, that's your invitation to stand. It's your invitation to kneel. And after this song, I want prayer teams to be ready to come. And if you want to pray and solidify anything, this is going to be your opportunity to do it. You ready to sing? Let's move into that time right now. Ushers, come. People of God, sing like people who've already been set free.
Old things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that we thought were dead are breathing in life again. You cause your sun to shine on darkest nights. For all that you've done, we will pour out our love. This will be our anthem song. Sing it, Jesus, we have found their hope. The old
Come, lift it up to Jesus.
Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one. Our hearts adore.
I want us to sing it again. Just pour your affection on Jesus one more time.
Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one. Our hearts adore.
Right now, if you need anything from God, if you're tired of being stuck, tired of the same old, same old, tired of living in the wilderness, whatever your wilderness might be, I want to encourage you to start moving in this direction. We've got a host of prayer teams. They're here to serve you. So the way we're going to be dismissed today is the team's just going to sing that chorus, and this is your invitation to come forward. It's your invitation to come forward. If all the teams are filled, just take a seat on the front and somebody will be right with you. But let's sing this up to God. May you step into your promised land today. Out of your wilderness, into your promised land. Team, would you lead us? Start moving this direction. After this course, you're free to be dismissed. The team will sing just a bit longer. God bless as you sing.
Jesus, we love you.
Jesus, we love you.